In this video, we'll discuss how genes can be linked. This discovery was made based on genetic studies of gene transmission in the Drosophila melanogaster fruit fly. So, how can we study the linkage between genes on the same chromosome? Let's consider two traits of Drosophila melanogaster. One is the color of the eyes, denoted as PR for purple eyes and PR+ for red eyes, and the other is the shape of the wings, denoted as VG+ for normal wings and VG for vestigial wings. Both of these genes are on chromosome 2. We'll start with true breeding parents. One is a female with purple eyes and vestigial wings. She carries two copies of the PR allele responsible for purple eyes and two copies of the VG allele responsible for vestigial wings. This true breeding female is crossed with a true breeding male with red eyes and normal wings. This is characterized by two copies of the PR+ allele for red eyes and two copies of the VG+ allele for normal wings. In the first generation, denoted as F1, 100% of the progeny receive a copy of the PR allele and a copy of the PR+ allele from each parent. They also receive a copy of the VG allele and a copy of the VG+ allele from each parent. The phenotype of this F1 generation has red eyes with normal wings. This indicates that the allele for red eyes, PR+, is dominant over the allele for purple eyes, PR. Also, the allele for normal wings, VG+, is dominant over the allele for vestigial wings. Now, let's take a female from the first generation that has red eyes and normal wings and cross her with a double recessive homozygous male. This male has two copies of the recessive PR allele, meaning he would have purple eyes. Also, he has two copies of the VG allele, so he would have vestigial wings. This type of cross is called a test cross. It's a cross between one parent from the F1 generation and a double homozygous recessive of the two traits that are being studied. The results of this test cross are progeny with four possible phenotypes: purple eyes with normal wings, red eyes with vestigial wings, purple eyes with vestigial wings, and red eyes with normal wings. Now we need to figure out the respective proportion of each of these linked phenotypes. We know that there are four possible outcomes, so let's consider the predictions. If we follow Mendel's second law, these traits, eye color and wing shape, will segregate independently. This means that the four possible genotypes and corresponding phenotypes are equally probable. This would mean we would find 25% of each phenotype in the progeny. Two phenotypes are the parental phenotypes. These include progeny with red eyes and normal wings, or purple eyes and vestigial wings. The other two are recombinant phenotypes. These include progeny with red eyes and vestigial wings, or purple eyes and normal wings. However, both genes are on the same chromosome and should segregate together. Therefore, we would only get 50% of each parental phenotype and no recombinant phenotypes. This would result in only the parental phenotypes, red-eyed with normal wings and purple-eyed with vestigial wings. We would not expect to see the other phenotypes that are recombinations or recombinants of the two parental phenotypes. However, Morgan's research group observed something in between during their experiments. They observed that 40% of each of the parental phenotypes and 10% of each recombinant class were present. The conclusion is that the observed frequency of recombinant phenotypes was lower than predicted by Mendel's second law, but higher than if both genes segregated together. Morgan's hypothesis was that an exchange had happened between homologous chromosomes during oogenesis, which he called a crossover. As a result, rare but not impossible rearrangements between genes that are normally linked with each other could occur. This led to a small fraction of the recombinant phenotypes. Now let's look at the assortment of three different traits that are all found on the same chromosome. Here we have two homologous chromosomes, one in orange and one in green. The first chromosome carries the uppercase A, uppercase B, and uppercase C alleles, and the second chromosome carries the corresponding lowercase a, lowercase b, and lowercase c alleles. A crossover could take place, for example, between uppercase A and uppercase B, or uppercase A and uppercase C. We know, based on the position of these two genes, that the distance between A and C is longer than the distance between A and B. After recombination, the first crossover would produce a recombinant chromosome carrying uppercase A with lowercase b. The second recombinant chromosome would carry a lowercase a with an uppercase b. The likelihood of a crossover between genes A and B is low because genes A and B are close to each other. Therefore, the recombination frequency between A and B will be small. In contrast, you can expect a higher recombination frequency between genes A and C because they are further apart. This reasoning suggests that the frequency of crossover and recombination between two genes on the same chromosome is proportional to the physical distance between the alleles. The crossover frequency is proportional to the physical distance of alleles along the chromosome. This shows that the recombination frequency between two alleles can be used to estimate their physical distance along a chromosome. Knowing this, if we can determine the pairwise recombination frequency between a series of genes along the same chromosome, we can build genetic maps that show the relative position of these genes. It's important to note that when genes are carried on the same chromosomes but far apart from each other, the frequency of recombination is relatively high, and these genes will appear to segregate independently. Let's look at an example of a genetic map. The first genetic map was published by a graduate student, Peter Sturtevant, who was a member of Morgan's research group. Sturtevant used pairwise crossing to determine the position of six genes. These genes were denoted as uppercase B, C, O, P, M, and R, and were found along the X chromosome. The table shows the experimental data from Sturtevant's experiment. He found that there was no crossover when looking at a pairwise crossing between the C and O alleles. This meant that the C and O alleles had the same position on the chromosome. When he looked at the recombination between the B allele and the C and O alleles, he saw the percentage of recombination was 1%. For crosses between the C, O, and P alleles, the percentage of recombination was 29.7%. The pairwise crosses between the P and R alleles resulted in a recombination frequency of 3%, while the pairwise crosses between the P and M alleles gave a recombination frequency of 26.9%. Based on these recombination percentages, Sturtevant established the first genetic map that showed the position of these six X-linked genes relative to the position of the alleles. So, we can see that there is a recombination frequency of 1% between alleles B and C. Then, if we look at alleles C and P, we see that there is a recombination frequency of 29.7%. Morgan also did control crosses between alleles B and P, for which he got a recombination frequency of around 30.7%. This confirmed the distance that he had previously calculated. This established a genetic map based on the frequency of recombination that positions these six alleles along the X chromosome. These positions don't represent actual physical distance, but rather the genetic distance based on the recombination frequency. In other words, this distance is based on the percentage of crossover. As you now know, Sturtevant and Morgan conducted all of these genetic experiments in fruit flies. In contrast, when Mendel established his laws of genetic inheritance, he used pea plants. Why would Sturtevant and Morgan not have chosen to conduct these studies in pea plants too? Relative to pea plants, flies have a shorter generation time, which allows for rapid analysis of numerous progeny from various crosses. This enables us to easily measure low-frequency crossover events, leading to the creation of accurate genetic maps. In conclusion, based on these experiments, we know that chromosomes are a linear array of linked genes. Studying recombination events between these linked genes helps to determine their relative positions and allows us to create detailed genetic maps of different chromosomes.